Hello everyone, thank you so much for the opportunity to discuss this work with you. This is joint with my very talented colleague Lili Varga of the Hungarian Demographic Research Institute, who is nice enough to let me freeload on her productivity and stick my name on her hard work. So this work is part of the Agenda project, a lot of what I'll be analyzing, and also part of the Counting Women's Work project, which is doing a lot of the same work with national time transfer accounts, but in lower and middle income countries. So I'll be discussing the quantity-quality trade-off, so a cross-country comparison of market and non-market investments per child in relation to fertility. So some background on this, we've been talking about national transfer accounts, most of us have been working on them for many years. So NTA starts with the idea of disaggregating national accounts by age to understand how societies transfer resources to dependent age groups. And so NTA takes this idea of dependency and gives it a very specific data-driven meaning, that dependency is defined when you are consuming more than you're producing. So that allows us to talk about changing age structure, the burden of dependency, in a very specific operationalized way. But what's missing from that is that national accounts, on which NTA builds upon, doesn't include a lot of things, but for our purposes right now, the most important one is that it doesn't include non-market care time production or consumption. And so this makes national accounts sort of uniquely unable to measure dependency in a real way. Think about when you, if you decide to start a family or not, what are you thinking about what you need to afford? You need to afford the goods and services for any children you might have, but you also are definitely have to plan on the time. Who is going to take care of the child during its infancy when it is most time intensive? How are you going to balance that burden with labor force, with needs to participate in the labor force? And then when you think about planning for your own retirement and aging process, at some point you're going to need care inputs. And are you going to have the money to buy those in the market? Are you going to receive those for free from family members or community members? So these unpaid care time inputs are at the very heart of what we want to understand when we're thinking about the burden of dependency at different age groups. And so that being not part of NTA, why does that matter? So as I was saying, we sort of misestimate this economic concept of dependency. In other realms of economic investigation, you can have similar kinds of problems. It's also a problem because it leaves out much of what women contribute to economies. And I'm not going to focus on that in this particular research, but in every country we look at in NTA, and that everyone else looks at, women are spending more time than men on unpaid care work, and men are spending more time than women on market work. There's a lot of crossover, everybody's working in all the spheres, but there is specialization. And so to consistently leave out household production and unpaid care work is to systematically make invisible a lot of what women are contributing to economies and social reproduction. So our solution, and it was the NTA project's aim from very early on to add this piece, is to have the national time transfer accounts. So that is taking the NTA framework and methodology, where we are focused on average economic activity by age group, and also the system of transfers, and accounting for all flows, in current flows, and adds that to the long-standing methodology for household production, satellite accounting. That methodology is based on time use surveys, where we can observe the amount of time people spend in unpaid care work, how much time they're spending on direct child care, care for elders, disabled, sick people in their households and community, and then also how much time they spend on housework, cooking, cleaning, laundry, things like that, also household management and maintenance on an unpaid basis. And once we observe the amount of time people are spending on those activities in time use surveys, we impute a wage to that time to get a monetary value. And the wage imputation that we use here is replacement method. So the idea is, in a thought experiment, if people, instead of doing those activities themselves, said, I'm going to go pay someone to do that in the market. How much would I have to pay them? And this is opposed to the opportunity cost method, which says that thought experiment is someone's not going to do that for themselves. Instead, they're going to take their time and apply it to their highest returning market work. That's a different situation here, though. Instead, we're in the replacement idea. So given that we've developed these national time transfer accounts and add them to NTA, so how does that inform, how does that change the conclusions that we make from different kinds of economic analyses? And so what I'm going to talk about here is what it does when we are trying to understand and measure the evidence for a quantity-quality trade-off. So economic demographers, people who study fertility, very familiar with the quantity-quality trade-off hypothesis of Gary Becker that posited that your fertility decisions are not just about how many children you want to have, but also of the child quality as well. And so, of course, it's a pretty controversial idea to talk about a child's quality. They're all infinitely valuable. But to say how much we're going to spend on inputs to that child. So if we have a budget constraint, we have a limited amount to spend, we have to just choose not only how many children to have, but how much to spend on each one. And so in this idea, lower fertility can be associated with higher quality. You have fewer children, you spend more on each. And so the looking for data to test this hypothesis, most of those efforts have involved market inputs. So we have Barrow and Lee, who used educational spending on education as a proxy for child quality. Various members of the NTA group and others have used education and health investments, and then or also general consumption altogether, including food, clothing, and shelter, not just health and education. So, but those are all pretty much market inputs. If we want to imagine the extended quantity quality theory, which also includes the time cost of children, there we have care provided at home is investments more narrowly defined, and another that focuses on total spending per child, so including more types of spending. So this slide, I think more than any of them, makes for me the argument that we have to include the time inputs to adequately understand the costs of children. So this is age across the x-axis, and we have per capita for each age group. And again, this is normalized in these units of peak labor income for age 30 to 49, peak working age labor income. And so this is spending on kids for different kinds of human capital investments. This group down here is the market piece. We have public health goods and services, publicly provided education. The blue pieces here are private health and education. They're pretty small. That's mostly because this sample is weighted towards European countries, where the public sector is a much bigger player compared to the private sector than in some countries in Asia, than in the US. But so for this sample, this is pretty small. And here is unpaid child care provided mostly by parents and grandparents. There's some other household and family members in there. But yeah, so if you are trying to understand any costs of children without including this piece, and think about the fact that this also is taking a replacement child care worker wage, and in most countries, a child care worker wage is very low, that this is huge. This is a huge part of the cost of children. So this is the human capital investment piece. What does it look like if I also include more general spending on children, both in the market and the household? So you get this graph. Again, this is by age of children up to 26. And now we're going to add, on the unpaid care work side, other services at home. So this is children's share of the general housework. And then private market spending is added here, so food, clothing, shelter. And then public market spending is this new piece here. So that's sort of children's share of general public administration. And so I have four children up to age 26. These measure of spending on children in all of these different categories. And if I add up the area of all these curves, what I get is a synthetic cohort measure of the total spending on children. So that would assume zero child mortality up to age 26. That's what I would have to spend on a child. So how does that relate to fertility? So first we'll look at that synthetic cohort measure relative to average labor income compared to fertility. And these are 5-year period total fertility rates from the UN data set for the year that is closest to the NTA set of age profiles. So we have age profiles for each country for 1 year, and these are around 2000 to 2010, and compare that to the fertility around that time. So this is just the market inputs in human capital, and this is a sort of reproduction of what Andy Mason and co-authors did a while ago, and we see a pretty tight relationship. Granted, it's determined down here by Ghana and Senegal. It would be nice to have more observations in this area, but even if we didn't have these two, we would still see some negative relationship. The R squared, doing a regression on the log-log of these two quantities, is 0.6. And now what does that look like for the unpaid care work side? So this is direct child care compared to fertility. So we again see this negative, pretty dependable negative relationship. If we took out Ghana and Senegal, we would see probably a much steeper one, but we still have sort of statistical significance. Now, if we add those two together, and so this graph puts the market inputs together with the childcare that I just showed you, and the relationship gets even tighter. R squared is now 0.71, elasticity of negative 0.67. So, and it's discussed in the paper more, but there is also evidence that there's some trade-off, that in some places where you have the same fertility, some countries are putting more of the inputs into those kids in terms of unpaid care work time. Some countries are doing more on the market side. So when you put them together, the relationship tightens up a little bit. What about the measures of total spending? So here we see total spending on the market side compared to fertility, and there's not much of a relationship. Total spending in terms of unpaid care work time, so this includes direct care and children's share of general housework. There we have a relationship again, very much determined down here by Ghana and Senegal, but still, even if we were only looking across these countries, some indication of a negative relationship. And the R squared about 0.53 for the log-log relationship. So total spending per child, combining these market inputs with the unpaid care work piece that I had in the previous slide, we're back to sort of having a recognizable relationship for total spending and fertility. So there definitely is support of this relationship we would expect in a quantity-quality trade-off world where higher fertility ends up with lower spending, lower investments per child, and lower fertility, higher investments. Excuse me. So what we see is that unpaid child care received at home is an important and significant part of human capital investments. And again, I would emphasize the fact that when we are talking about research on inputs to children, on child care, on what having children does to labor market outcomes, to leave this piece out, to leave the unpaid care work piece out, is to misestimate a lot of the dynamics. And we saw also the education and health investment measures combined with direct child care and the total market and non-market spending per child both have evidence of the quantity-quality trade-off. We saw also that this quantity-quality trade-off operates both in the market and non-market channels, and at least on the human capital side, strengthen them when putting them together, suggesting trade-off and sort of different strategies for inputs into children. And these results are going to relate to policy issues in a lot of different areas. So demographic dividends and the burden of dependency. are going to be affected. And also dynamic models, when we're talking about capital deepening, we can also use these kinds of inputs to talk about human capital deepening. That's exactly the same dynamic. If you were able to invest more human capital time into children with fewer children, then that may also, down the road, mitigate the effects of population aging in the same way that physical capital could. The cost of childbearing and who pays them, that's also going to be something that this kind of research speaks to. And then issues of gender equity I didn't highlight during the talk, but certainly as part of the Agenda data on national transfer accounts and time transfer accounts, and the data that Counting Women's Work will be able to make available, all of these pieces are separated out by gender, and we'll be able to do a lot more work on the gender equity issues. Thank you very much. I look forward to questions.
So I think we take two questions and a third one if it's very important.
So censor yourself.
May I suggest that you answer directly? I think this is more the character of a discussion.
Thank you, Gretchen, for your talk. So the quantity-quality trade-off is about the, fertility and education. And I wonder, in order to have a complete picture, why don't you relate your very nice measure to education outcome? You know, does it pay to make such so important investment, you know, in kids in terms of the education outcome? Not only relating them to fertility, you see what I mean?
So you mean taking the investments in sort of time one and then looking at the educational distribution in time two?
Yes, it's related to the cohort, but to see whether there is a relationship, you know, on all those investment and the outcome in terms of education for those kids, you know.
Yeah, that's a good idea. That's some, definitely something we could do, and certainly with the Wittgenstein Center's education projection data, mm-hmm. that would be a great place to use both those data sources together. Thank you. That's a good suggestion.
Very nice, very interesting. But I wonder, how should we think about, let's see, if you spend an hour with one child, it's clear enough who's getting it. If you spend an hour with two kids, does each of the kids only get a half hour of benefit, or do they both get a whole hour of benefit, or how do we think about it?
Yeah.
And then as fertility declines, someone has to be taking care of even the one child all day. Mm-hmm. Do you capture is the average amount of time spent the marginal gain when fertility declines?
Yeah.
Those kinds of things are hard to think about. Mm-hmm.
Well, so in the methodology, we do divide the time up. So if there are two kids and one parent, they are getting half the time that parent is spending, because we sort of have to preserve the hour. We have to preserve 24 hours given and 24 hours received. I can't have 24 hours given and 48 hours received. So whether that sort of methodological decision makes a completely harebrained assumption on what the child actually receives, at least in terms of the human development literature, there is some support for the idea that kids in a group are receiving less than kids by themselves. Now, I also saw some recent development saying that first children have better outcomes because they actually are better sort of future success, because they are the ones who end up teaching their younger siblings, and that enhances their own neurological development and all sorts of other good things. So that kind of made me sad, because I don't know what the heck to do about that. Sort of sibling time transfers and human capital investments. So a little bit of the research will support my idea of reducing what you receive if you're actually fighting with your sibling for attention. But it certainly is something, it's a big assumption made in the methodology that we probably need to consider a lot more what the ramifications are for interpreting the outcome.
Is there another urgent question? Oh yes, there is one.
It's a problem with other MTA expenditures also.
It's up to your judgment if the questions are urgent. First of all, why didn't you use opportunity cost measures? Because it could make some difference given the diversity of market versus non-market childcare in various countries. Secondly, did you give causality any thought?
No, we did not give causality any thought, other than to say that these are cross-sectional relationships. There are cross-sectional relationships across a really diverse group of countries at very diverse levels of socioeconomic development. So there are some sort of regression equations in the paper that sort of control for, say, income groups. But we could do more with that, trying to sort of separate other issues that could contaminate the direct relationship. But again, causality, cross-section, macro is always a heavy lift. And your other question, so opportunity cost. So the if we're talking about the value of inputs, I would say yes, that it would be worth it to try to do an opportunity cost version for the direct childcare inputs, the exact amount of time, because also in the human development literature, there is plenty of evidence for the fact that children of higher educated parents receive sort of a higher quality input in that one-on-one time. They hear more words, they get read to more, all this sort of stuff. So, so that we should definitely try, you know, to do that as well. In our in a lame defense, is sort of doing that again across 25 countries is again pretty difficult to do. But on the sort of general household services, I would not want to say that a load of clean laundry received is worth any more if I, with my PhD, do it than if somebody who did not have a PhD in demography did it. So there in the general household services, I would say replacement is better. But yes, in the direct child care, we should probably give a care to trying to figure out how we can, across these countries, implement an alternative.